As you know, today's topic for discussion is business environment and introduction. And this present discussion covers what is business environment, what are the economic factors influencing business, what are the political and legal aspects to be covered, what are the socio-economic factors influencing business activities, and technological factors which is influencing business activities, etc. To discuss these aspects, we have two subject experts along with me, Mr. K. Ishwar Prasad, Department of Economics, Pragati Mahavidyalaya, Hyderabad. Next to him is Dr. YKM Naidu, Department of Commerce, Pragati Mahavidyalaya, Hyderabad. What is business, right? What should be the goal of any business enterprise?
Yes.
Please.
Business is an organized effort by a firm to produce goods and services to the satisfaction of the consumers. And a business is influenced by a number of surrounding factors such as political, social, cultural, and other environmental issues. The goals of a business are widely different, and the economic theory was all the while obsessed with profit maximization as the only goal of a business firm. As students of BCom and undergraduate level, you are all taught only one thing, that a firm tries to maximize its profits. But in reality and in practice, a business firm never tries to maximize the profit. Most of the business firms aim at widely varied objectives to be achieved, or firms may even try to maximize their managerial utility or the managerial satisfaction, because the managers who are the board of directors elected by the shareholders, they get a lot of pleasure in spending a large amount of money to maximize their utility rather than the profits of the firm as such. Firms also do try to exercise a large amount of power with them. For example, you can see that Ambani's, Tata's, Birla's, all these business firms wants to achieve what is called as power maximization as such. Firms try to maximize the welfare of their employees, particularly the workers, because contented workers will add to the growth, profit, sales, everything of the firm as such. There goes a Chinese proverb that if you are going to plan for 1 year, invest in Karan. If you want to plan for 30 years, then grow a tree. But if you want to plan for 100 years, invest in man. Now, this shows that how people and employees and their satisfaction is very much relevant and important.
Dr. Naidu, what do you mean by business environment? Yes, and what factors influencing business activities?
Just as we have environment at our houses, even a business enterprise is not free from influences, and environment refers to the totality of all the forces which have a bearing on the functioning of the business. To tell you very frankly, a business cannot operate in isolation without knowing or without scanning the environmental factors. And the objective of every business manager is to succeed in his endeavor, and as we all know, today the market is too crowded, there is a lot of competition, and as the going gets tough, the tough only get going, and it is very clear that it is only the fittest who is going to survive. Therefore, I would rather say that environment contains the Mula Mantra for the success of a firm. Any firm which ignores the influence of environment will definitely, you know, meet death. So I have no exaggeration in telling that a firm which is not aware of the environment has no right to carry on the business, because business involves the money invested by the shareholders and creditors, and A business organization is responsible to the society also. And today, in the new millennium, environment has become so crucial that any organization which ignores the environment is definitely going to lose its business to its competitors. Today, there are three important things in the business environment, that is challenge, change, and competition. A business firm which is alert will definitely be able to meet all the three things which I have just mentioned. And today, in order to be effective, every business manager should underline these things as very important, because they are the basic, you know, things without which he cannot take any decision. And as you all know, the basic duty of a manager is to take good decision. Therefore, I would like to link up good decision making with proper scanning of the environment. There is life, there is prosperity, there is profitability, and of course, continuity of the firm only when a thorough scanning of the environment is made. Environment is very crucial for a business manager, and it is having a direct link with business. Business and environment are almost like wife and husband. Each must try to understand each other, and it is not a question of one being more than the other. It is a question of interdependence, that's all. Therefore, business and environment are very crucial in order to emerge as the winner. And today, the writing on the wall is very clear. It is only the winning attitude which can fetch profits. Therefore, I would definitely say that environment is very important for a business firm. It has to scan the environment. It has to find out what are the likely challenges, and it has to gear up, you know, its own resources accordingly, because business is not, you know, just like investing money and getting profits. Yes.
What could be the economic activities or factors influencing the business?
Now, to start with, the most important economic variable that influences the business decision making process is nothing but the economic philosophy or the economic system that a country adopts. All of you know that in the economic systems, there are three types of systems called capitalism, socialism, and the mixed economic systems. The decision making process in each system varies from that of the other, and the three central issues which are to be solved by any economy depends upon what type of economic philosophy that you are going to follow. For example, in a socialistic economy, the process of taking decisions of what to produce, how to produce, and for whom to produce, the three central issues as enunciated by Samuelson, were answered in one way, where the government takes the decisions, wherein its extreme polar opposite, that is capitalism, the business decision making will be done by the private entrepreneurs, and the via media, like that of India, the decision making is partly taken by the government and partly by the private individuals. Therefore, unless the business firm understands the philosophy of the government and its political and economic policies, it cannot take appropriate and crucial decisions. Secondly, economic planning is one thing that India has embarked upon from the year 1951 onwards. And in a system of planned economic development, the objectives and priorities fixed by the government in each plan will definitely have a bearing on what is called as the decision making process and viability, survival, and profits of the business firms as such. Then, a country like India, where 70% of the population still lives in the rural areas, and agriculture is the prime occupation, it is the agricultural sector's performance that influences the prosperity and the progress of a business. For example, the farm productivity and farm incomes create demand for a number of consumer goods that are produced in the industrial sector, and the farm sector also supplies a number of raw materials that are required for the agro-based industries. Then the government policies the most important factor is government policies. Government comes out with a number of policies, the most important of them being the fiscal policy relating to taxes, public debt, public expenditure and so on. The monetary policy relating to the money supply, which is being generally guided by the monetary policy or the credit policy of the Reserve Bank of India, which will be announced twice in a year. One is the peak season credit policy and the other is the slack season credit policies. Then you have the policy relating to the industrial growth and development, industrial policies, policies relating to the foreign exchange, then exchange rate managements, policies relating to the development of small scale industries. So many policies, right, options that are available with the government, and the government frequently keeps on changing them in order to fit the industrial development into those activities, right, which it wants are most priority and important, so that the productive resources of the economy will be diverted into the desired lines and channels. Therefore, the overall economic environment has to be taken care of by the business firms in decision making process.
How the political and legal factors affecting the business activities?
At the outset, I would like to direct your attention towards the newspaper headlines. Okay. Almost 20% of a newspaper comprises the decision of the government on the business activities. Yes. We hear that the High Court has admitted so and so case relating to so and so business.
Yeah.
Right? Political and legal environment, they develop, they shape, they direct and control the business activities. In this sense, a business is not going to operate without knowing the indication coming from the political and legal environment.
Yes.
Political environment is influenced by three major institutions.
Okay.
That is, in India, we have legislature on one side, the executive on one side and the judiciary on one side. And as we all know, the legislature decides the course of action.
Yeah.
That is, in the assembly and parliament, bills are passed.
Yeah.
And then the executive, that is the government, implements the decisions taken in the parliament, or you know, the legislature decisions are implemented by the executive. And the judiciary in India is like a watchdog.
Yeah.
And the focus of judiciary would be public interest.
Okay.
In the sense, neither the government nor the business houses can flout public interest. If anything comes in the way of the public interest, the judiciary sees to it that it is not, you know, done that way, and it puts sense into the business and also the government. There are many instances which we read in the newspapers and magazines where, you know, the decision of the business house, or let us say the decision of the government, have been reversed. In the sense, in India, we have a lot of what you call decision making coming from the government.
Yeah.
And the political environment gives the green signal, or it might give the red signal to the entry of the business concerns. That is one thing. And what is more important is, from 91 onwards, we are depending more on foreign investments. We are attracting the NRI deposits, and we are also, you know, expecting more funds coming from the foreign investors. And this again depends on the attitude of the government. That is, it is the political environment which is going to attract the investments or push away the investments. And as we all know, the winds of globalization and liberalization and privatization are because of what you call the changes in the political environment. And then coming to legal environment, it is very clear that no business firm can run its activities on its own. Legal environment is like a noose in the neck of the business people in one sense, because any violation of the legal environment would attract penalty and punishment. The owners or the business people, they might not be doing certain things willingly, but it is the legal environment which forces them to abide by the rules and regulations. Whether they like it or not, they have to do it.
Yes.
And no explanations are admitted on the part of the business people as far as the legal environment is concerned. The Workmen's Compensation Act, then again we have the Industrial Disputes Act, then we have the Companies Act, then the Securities Act, that is the control of SEBI over the issue and sale of shares. All these are, you know, just a part of the coin. And I don't think it is an exaggeration when I say that India is a country which is having a bundle of legislations. India is called as a country with a bundle of legislation because, you know, right from our entering out of the house till we come back, in one way or the other, there is some kind of a legal, what you call, impact on us.
Yeah.
So business is also no excuse for that. Right from the, you know, morning till the evening, there will be one or the other botheration by the legal representatives who would like to enforce things in the better interest of the people.
Yeah, which protects the consumers from the unfair trade practices or so on and so forth. Do you think that the judiciary really have been playing its role as a watchdog?
This is an interesting question. The role of judiciary when it comes to, there are two things. Judicial intervention is necessary.
Yeah.
There is no excuse and escape from it. But sometimes what happens is judicial overactivism, that's what we say, that over intervention by the judiciary is also equally dangerous. Because unfortunately, with all due respects to the judiciary and the judicial system, that there were areas where the judicial practices were often ignored. The judgment given by one court is not respected by the other courts. And this creates a lot of confusion, particularly for the business community. So this type of inconsistency in interpretation of laws should be avoided as far as possible by the judiciary. And they have to follow and stick to the what are called as the judicial principles that were laid down, the values that were laid down for a long time. Otherwise, you know, the judgments differ, right? One in one case, one will be given exemption, in the other case he will be penalized, another will be penalized, and this type of problems are being created by the judiciary. Yes.
What is the structural adjustment policy and how political stability can be assessed in case of business organization?
The year 1991, the year in which P.V. Narasimha Rao headed the minority government in the center, picked up Manmohan Singh as the finance minister, and Manmohan Singh has introduced this economic reforms 1991. The question is that these reforms were a drastic deviation from the existing policies of the government. We will say that it's what is popularly called as U-turn or turnaround in the economic policies. They have started the three important policies called liberalization, privatization, globalization. Added to that, the fourth one is stabilization. All the four put together is what we call it as the structural adjustment program initiated by the government of India. And by 1991 again we have introduced reforms. Freedom to controls to freedom is called as a U-turn in economic policies as such. Now this created a lot of confusion among the students and also many people that when freedom is that good, why there were controls? I should tell only one thing. What is the right medicine at one point of time? Maybe the wrong medicine at a different point of time. The economic environment, as it keeps on changing, the policies have to change. So the controls of introduced from 50s to 70s are essential. They are required. When particularly when the economy is underdeveloped and the people are suffering from poverty, misery, underdeveloped nature of industry, so on and so forth. I, with due respect to everyone, I can say that the public sector is not supposed to make 100% profits. By its very nature, public sector is supposed to run under losses. Under backward area development, you have established public sector projects in areas where nothing is available. How can you expect the public sector to make profits? You have made the public sector to produce commodities, right, which require a long gestation period. There won't be even a single unit of output coming out of it for years together. You cannot expect public sector to produce profits in the short term. It's part and parcel of the game. And the public sector, right, when it has done its job and the Indian economy was lifted to a level of what is called as a development, where it can withstand the competition, not only from the Indian private entrepreneurs, but also from the multinationals coming from out of the country. The government thought it's better now. The government should focus more on social sectors rather than on industrial development. Therefore, the government has started this program of what is called as a denationalization and disinvestment in the public sector, and giving more freedom to the private entrepreneurs. This is what we call the program of disinvestment and liberalization. And liberalization, when it comes to that, is a number of controls imposed on the private entrepreneurs have been withdrawn by the government after 1991, because under MRTP controls, licensing controls, right, then FARA controls, the industry which is having the ability to invest more, expand into new areas of production, was not in a position to do it because of the government regulations. This limited the growth of the firm, and as the growth of the firm has been stopped, it could not take advantages of the large scale production. When it could not get the advantages of large scale production, it could not reduce its costs, increase the competitiveness. So the government rightly thought that it has to remove some of these controls, particularly the MRTP controls and FARA restrictions, so that the industry can produce on a large scale. So then it increased the competition among the firms. And with increased competition, quality has improved. Consumer got some respect. If not, you cannot say that consumer is the sovereign, but consumer got some respect. Post-sale services have improved. Now we are all finding a number of mass consumer goods available in the market with a lot of what is called as post-sale service packages being offered by the firm. All this credit should go to the 1991 industrial policy. Then the third component is globalization. What is this globalization? Removing restrictions on the free flow of goods and services across the countries is called as globalization. This can be done by permitting free flow of goods, free flow of services, free flow of investments from one country to another, by tariff reductions, by removing the quantitative restrictions, etc.
How technological environmental factors or technology as a factor influencing the business activity, please?
Technology has a striking balance on business activities. Today, if you look at the wonderful products and the varied services which are offered, we really feel, you know, that we are almost in a heaven, and this is only because of the impact exerted by technology. Technology has the power to change lives, and consumers are, you know, bestowed with so many choices that it is only the technological edge which makes them pick up the product of their choice from the basket. A businessman has to focus more on the technological development, because what has been apt till yesterday, by today it becomes obsolete. For example, if you look at the healthcare activities, we will be surprised. Today, there is nothing like a dark person, you know, saying that I am dark, because you have your products like Fair and Lovely and other beauty care services, which almost, you know, convert a black looking person into a fair looking person. And that reduces the cost, and as well as it gives a competitive edge. So what matters in business is the competitive edge, because there are so many people who are offering, you know, the product, but it is only the firm which has what you call an edge over the others, that is preferred. So technological advancement helps or enhances the profitability of the firms, because when the going gets tough, only the tough get going. So it is only the technological edge which is going to fetch lots of sales to the firms. No doubt it is going to cost something, but the return on investment is definitely going to be better, and it also enhances the image.
As we know, what is budget? Because it is a part and parcel of economic factor, yes. Our economic environment is concerned. But what is budget, and what is the impact of, or how does it influence the real business activities? Please brief.
Budget is the income expenditure statement of the government for a particular year. That is called the budget. And the government, when it mobilizes the income to meet the expenditure, it comes out with what are called as two important factors called as taxes, and the other is called debt, public debt. Now, as far as the taxes are concerned, there are direct taxes and indirect taxes. And the direct tax policies and the indirect tax policies, particularly customs duty, excise duties, etc., have a definite bearing on what is called as the industry and the business firms as such. If the finance minister gives concession or reduces the taxes on electronic goods, that means that there will be prosperity for the electronics industry. Okay. If he increases the taxes on some other commodity, then that obviously it means that they want to discourage the production of those commodities. So definitely business people have a lot of interest and concern in the budget. And you see that the stock exchanges, right, fluctuating with every statement made by the finance minister, which shows how responsive and how immediate the reactions are for the government budget as such.
Thank you, Mr. Ishwar Prasad. And due to time constraint, we are not unable to continue our discussion. Let me thank Ishwar Prasad and Dr. Naidu for coming over here, and elaborative discussion had, which will help our students at large. And I thank you one and all.